Okay, welcome to the fifth lecture. We are still in paragraph 2, basics and preliminaries, where I grab some results from other courses, from other lectures, and present them here. Last time we looked at least square solution and minimum norm solutions. So what was the idea there? I've already written this down. We wish to solve Ku equals G, usually for a linear operator from some Banach space X to some Banach space Y. And Ku equals G might not be solvable, so we define the least square solution as the somehow best solution of Ku equals G, so that the norm of Ku minus G is minimal. So we choose U if we choose U in the argmin of Ku minus G squared, then U is a least square solution. I'm taking that two norm squared here, because usually we'll be looking at Hilbert spaces rather than Banach spaces. Now, there's a norm missing. There's a problem that this set might be empty, and I already reminded you of that, right? You have to choose it in, you have to choose G in the range of K plus the range of K perp. So that's not the whole space. So the square solution might not be defined for some G in infinite spaces. So in finite spaces, of course, everything's fine. Okay, and on the other hand, that least square solution might not be unique. So we take the least square solution with minimal norm and call it the minimum norm solution. Okay, so that was the idea, and that's exactly the same if you look back at your numerical linear algebra, except for the small remark that this might not always be defined. It's exactly the same definition as in numerical linear algebra and for finite dimensional vector spaces. So let me remind you what you usually do when you introduce this in numerical linear algebra. You have the minimum norm solution. You define the pseudo inverse and that's the operator that maps G to U plus. And then what you do is you use the SVD, singular value decomposition, to get a simple representation of K plus. Oh, K plus, excuse me. K plus pseudo inverse. Okay. So what is the singular value decomposition? You're using the representation Ku as the sum of all sigma k, k going from 1 possibly to infinity, uk scalar product with u times vk. And in the finite dimensional case, of course, there's not an infinity up here in the finite dimensional case. In the finite dimensional case, you have something like this. So this is a finite sum. Now that representation is called the singular value decomposition. And in numerical linear algebra, you show that it always exists in finite dimensional vector spaces. And just to remind you, what are the sigma k, uk, and vk? The sigma k squared are the positive eigenvalues of k star k, where these are matrices in finite dimensional vector spaces. Then UK is an orthonormal system of eigenvectors. Of k star k corresponding to these eigenvalues, and the vk, an orthonormal system of eigenvectors of kk star, and again with respect to these positive eigenvalues over there. Okay, so that always exists, and for finite dimensional vector spaces. And then what you show is that k plus u can be k plus g for any g can be written in the following way. This is the sum k from 1 to n, 1 over sigma k g scalar product with vk times uk. Okay, and if you remember, then this is a very nice representation of the pseudo inverse, and it's so nice. Actually, you can prove every property of the property of the pseudo inverse easily with this representation. This is something we would also like to use for infinite dimensional vector spaces. Okay, we would like to get something like a singular value decomposition for infinite dimensional vector spaces, and that means that we have to impose additional constraint. So the question is, which operators actually exist, possess a singular value decomposition with exactly the same properties as above? And we'll see that this is the space of compact operators. And so that's our motivation for defining compact operators. That's number one. And number two is, it turns out that many of the operators we encounter in inverse problems are actually compact operators. So they do possess a singular value decomposition, and they can be analyzed using that representation of the pseudo inverse. Okay, let's start with the definition. So now I think the goal is clear for today. I want to define what compact operators are. I want to give you some properties. And finally, the goal for today is I want to show you that every compact operator has a singular value decomposition. Okay, let's start with definition 215. Let X and Y be Banach spaces. And let me also say, since I'm going for the singular value decomposition, which obviously only makes sense for Hilbert spaces, at some point I will just restrict myself to Hilbert spaces. So, and also with the examples that I will give, I will often restrict myself to the L2 norm rather than to any LP norm. Everything can be much more generalized and can be written in a much more generalized way using LP norms. But the proofs are more or less always the same, and it doesn't add anything in insight. So I will often restrict myself to simpler cases, and this would be, I will often restrict myself to Hilbert spaces. Okay, so assume that K is a linear operator from X to Y. Now, K is called compact if and only if K of B closure is compact for all bounded sets B in X. So that's where the name comes from. But we'll usually use something else. A set is compact if it contains every sequence contains a convergent subsequence. So we will always use the simpler, usually simpler definition. For all bounded sequences, UN, KUN has convergent subsequence. UN in X, I should say, UN has a convergent subsequence. And convergent, this means that since I have the closure up there, it doesn't have to be convergent in B, it can just be convergent in X. More or less that says, well, it's a Cauchy sequence, right? Okay, so that's the definition. And just to give you some properties, so that's rather a remark. Remark 2.16. Let K1 and K2 compact. Then K1 plus K2 is compact. I will always abbreviate that with CP. Okay, everything as before, right? So all these operators always go from X to Y and so on. So let UN be a bounded sequence in X. Well, since K1 is compact, that means that UN, KUN, has a convergent subsequence and I call that KVN, right? VN is a subsequence of UN. I've just lost my mouse cursor. Ah, there it is. Okay, UN was bounded. VN is a subsequence of UN, so VN is bounded as well. So K2 is compact. So that means since VN is a subsequence of UN, we now have a subsequence of VN that is such that K prior to that subsequence is convergent. So there is a KVN has convergent subseries. Convergent subsequence, and that's KWN. WN is a subsequence of VN. And that means that K1 plus K2 applied to WN is the same as K1WN plus K2WN, but KWN is convergent, and K1W n, well, wn is a subsequence of vn, and k, vn was convergent, so this is convergent as well. So this is convergent. Okay, second remark. Let the range of K be finite dimensional. So let the range, or the dimension, of range of K smaller than infinity. And let's assume that K is continuous, which means that the operator norm of K is smaller than infinity. I say that in this case, K is compact. Why? The range of K, if it's finite dimensional, is isomorphic to Rn, where n is the dimension. And if you want, with any norm, because all norms are equivalent, take the two norm, doesn't matter. Now take any bounded K, bounded sequence un, so let me just write this down once. I think I will. So that of course means that un is smaller than some c for all n. Now, first of all, we have that kun is smaller than the norm of k times the norm of un, and the norm of k was smaller than infinity, norm of un was smaller than c, so this is, and this is bounded. We have a sequence in a bounded set. We have a bounded sequence in, now everything is isomorphic to Rn, and that means that bounded sequences have a convergent subsequence, for example, with Bolzano-Weierstrass, Heine-Borel. And that says that KUN has a convergent subsequence, which means that K is compact. Now, for this to be correct, we need that K is continuous. So the question is that necessary? And in fact, it is, because if K is compact, then K is continuous. Note that this was not in the definition. In the definition, we had just any linear operator. Okay, let's assume that K is not continuous. Which means that the norm of K is unbounded, so the sub over all norm U equals to 1 U in X, norm of KU goes to infinity. Is infinity, which means that we can find a sequence such that sequence UN with a property that the norm of UN of KUN, excuse me, is larger than N, and the norm of UN is 1. Okay, now let's see what, so obviously UN is bounded. All elements have norm 1, but I will show that it has no convergent subsequence. And the reason is simply that the norm of KUN minus KUM, well, that should be a Cauchy sequence, right? For any n and any m, this is larger than the norm of KUN. KUN minus norm of KUM. And if we assume N to be larger or equal to M, then the norm of KUN is at least N, not N larger than M, excuse me. When this is the same, it doesn't make too much sense, but if we take N to be larger than M, then this is N minus M, and it's definitely larger than 1, which means that elements in that sequence are at least one apart, so it can never have a convergent subsequence. So that means that K is not compact. So that means if it is compact, then it's also continuous. Last thing, assume now that K is an operator from X to Y, all Banach spaces. L is an operator from Y to Z. And we assume that both are continuous. If K is compact or L is compact, then KL is compact. Now, let's take a sequence in X, which is bounded. Now, if K is compact, if L is compact, then LUN has convergent subsequence and that subsequence, let's call that VN and LVN, and LVN converges to some V. Now, if it does that, then, excuse me, KLVN converges to K times V, since K is continuous. On the other hand, if K is compact, then, well, UN is bounded. So since L is continuous, we have that the norm of LUN is smaller than the norm of L times, well, the bound on UN, which I called C before. So LUN is bounded. Oops. Okay, since that's bounded, KLUN has a convergent subsequence. Subsequence let's call it KLWN, and well, that's exactly what we need. So in this case, again, we have that KL is compact. Okay, so that was the start. So it's just to get started with this, some simple properties. And now we'll switch to something a little bit